Modern medicine and technology have led to vast improvements in global health. Global life expectancy has increased drastically, and devastating diseases like smallpox and polio have sharply declined. Increasing international cooperation is a critical reason for these successes. In 1948, the World Health Organization was established to direct and coordinate responses to matters of international health. The organization launched programs to treat viruses like the flu, smallpox, and polio. In its early days, the WHO successfully addressed some of the most pressing health issues of the time.
So the World Health Organization, particularly coming out of the eradication of smallpox, was an incredibly well-respected institution. The concern that emerged after that was that the organization started to drift in its priorities.
Around this time, it became clear that the WHO was not well-equipped to respond effectively to emerging infections. The spread of HIV and drug-resistant tuberculosis revealed massive shortcomings. And as the diseases spread, the agency failed to contain them. In 2005, 196 countries agreed to the International Health Regulations, a set of rules that committed all parties to monitor and respond to outbreaks of disease in a coordinated, targeted way. The International Health Regulations, or IHR, obligated countries to identify and track outbreaks within their borders and determine a set of conditions for what constitutes an international emergency once a threat is detected.
When you declare that, that means you're dealing with an outbreak of some sort of a disease that has not only impact on the country in which the involvement is, but also has the clear potential to spreading out to other countries.
If an outbreak does constitute an international emergency, countries are bound by the IHR to work together to stop its spread while minimizing interference with international trade and travel. But despite these commitments, countries don't always follow the rules.
The challenge with that is regulations are voluntary. They don't have an enforcement mechanism. They also didn't come with more money. And what we found is in 2014, at least a third of WHO member countries still hadn't implemented, almost a decade later, most of the core requirements of the international health regulations.
While the Ebola crisis was a wake-up call for many, the international health regulations still have not been implemented by all WHO member countries. The cooperation required by the IHR is important because experts worry a serious pandemic is inevitable and that it may come from a pathogen currently unknown to cause disease. Birds and mammals harbor more than 600,000 unknown viruses that could jump to humans and become an international pandemic. Having the infrastructure to both detect and respond effectively to a so-called disease X is critical to saving lives in the future. But many countries don't have the capabilities, or the will, to adhere to the standards set by IHR, especially poorer countries. In 2014, the infectious virus Ebola spread through West Africa, ultimately killing more than 10,000 people.
It wasn't until March of 2014 when we saw that it was spreading from Guinea to Sierra Leone to Liberia that people say, my goodness, this is out of control, and the ball was dropped early on. And it wasn't until even months later that the WHO declared a public health emergency of international concern.
With a dangerously slow response from the WHO, Ebola moved fast. The idea that the virus could spread across the world spurred global panic. 21st century air travel posed a new challenge. Viruses can travel farther and faster than ever before. A virus like Ebola in West Africa can travel to the United States in less than a day, as it did in 2014. Panic spread quickly. Some concerned citizens and politicians pressed for a ban on travelers from infected countries as a way to stop Ebola from reaching US borders.
I think people believe that if you say, don't come, and we don't let anyone come, that that will prevent it from coming to our shores. And that's where the challenge comes in, because that is not actually what happens.
Health researchers and officials argue that, in actuality, travel bans keep medical professionals from reaching those in need and encourage those potentially infected to skirt the monitors at the border and enter undetected. They argue such policies ultimately do far more harm than good in protecting both Americans and people in the affected countries. Ultimately, Ebola infected 28,000 people from 10 countries. It took 2.5 years to be fully contained. WHO officials and its constituents saw it as a wake-up call that they had to work faster, especially as infectious diseases become more and more frequent.
The number of infectious disease outbreaks are rising because we've seen population growth and populations expanding into forested areas where they're more likely to encounter zoonotic diseases. At the same time, there's been an increase in trade and travel, both within countries and outside of countries, which make it less likely that diseases are going to burn out in the rural villages that they once might have.
The United States and other wealthy countries play a pivotal role in preventing and responding to pandemics, sending funds and medical workers around the world. This isn't solely a philanthropic notion, but a matter of national security.
Since we live in a world that is truly a global community, instability on any part of the world is a danger to us.
When it comes to global health crises, that is a place where the United States is often the leader. And part of that has to do with our role. When it becomes a global health crisis, it's about national security, diplomacy, health.
Because there is a disease X out there, collaborating, preparing, and adhering to standard procedures for global health security will be integral to stopping it in its tracks.
Disease X is the great unknown, something that was unanticipated, that turns out to be serious, that spreads rapidly and has a great deal of morbidity and mortality. That's what we refer to as disease X.